Welcome, everyone. And today we'll be talking about automated digital operations utilizing the power of cloud. Before we start, let's start with a simple introduction. Maybe I'll start with you, Ayman.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Vara. So Ayman Saidi, I'm a principal solution architect within the EC2 Edge 5G team, mainly focusing on new 5G initiatives.
Bejoy?
Hi, Bejoy, Pankajakshan here. I run technology and strategy for Mavenir.
Awesome. Ravi?
My name is Ravi Abdel. I lead the automation and security practice at AWS, working with customers, helping them automate and secure their workload in AWS.
So let's start the conversation. Bejoy, Mavenir has a vision of one network, all software. Could you walk us through the vision, please?
Sure. First of all, thank you for having Mavenir here. So Mavenir is around 15 to 17 years old now. So we started as a software company. So for us, always having our products and software and optimizing software is very important. As you know, telco operators started with private network deployments, and we need to make sure that our software is well optimized with the best footprint to run on private cloud. And in the last 5 to 6 years, I would say, you started seeing more interest in hyperscaler public cloud engagements, be it for hybrid cloud deployments or for just disaster recovery kind of scenarios. So making sure that our software can run in the private cloud as well as in AWS, where we started our initial relationship primarily with Dish as a customer, a joint customer for both of us, doing the first open RAN-based deployment. So it kind of really drove us towards getting our products optimized and getting beyond a proof of concept, which is where most of the industry was at that time. You've been doing a lot of proof of concepts to validate that this thing can run in the public cloud. Telco workloads can actually run in the public cloud. We took it to the next step in terms of realizing the vision of productizing and running it in a public cloud like AWS. Of course, for us, it's also about making sure it's a multi-generational technology. So working across 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G technologies, all in software for us. And the third piece of it is being able to run it all in software.
Awesome. And great journey that we had with you, we are really thankful for that. Can you talk us through how AWS was helping with your vision?
So the first part of it is, as I mentioned, it's about productizing that vision. So it's one thing to put it in a piece of paper and say and claim that we are a cloud-native company and we can run in multiple cloud environments, private or public cloud. The next thing is actually investing in that to productize your products for getting the best performance and making sure that it's integrated natively into the tools that the hyperscaler provides. Because a lot of talk in the industry about getting to lower cost, but unless you use the tools that are natively available in AWS, eliminate the underlying infrastructure which would come from third parties. So we did not choose to deploy on top of a VMware or Red Hat stack on AWS. We deployed natively on EKS, which meant that you're eliminating a third party there. And on top of it, when we integrate with EKS, you need to make sure that I'm using the tools that AWS provides. The CI/CD pipeline was very critical for Dish as a greenfield operator, making sure that they leverage all the benefits of automation. So getting that in and integrating it helped us accelerate, get to our vision of being able to demonstrate our product readiness in true GA quality across a full portfolio. So including RAN, packet core, IMS, messaging, voice, et cetera, running in a public cloud environment. And now we're much beyond Dish. Over the last 3 to 4 years, we've evolved it to multiple customers. The engagement has been pretty successful. We see requirements in Europe, for example, from Telefonica, to deploy full IMS there. The requirements there actually helped us evolve our products as well in terms of being able to run on top of Graviton. So everything earlier was x86 instance based. So we had to invest in making sure that these products which work well and are optimized on Intel x86 instances can now, even the software stacks that come from third parties are optimized to leverage the Graviton feature set. So that's also helped us differentiate in the market against some of our competition that's still doing proof of concept, but has got a lot of external marketing behind it.
Awesome. Thank you, Bejoy. And truly, that was a fantastic journey that we went through with you, and I was part of that working with your team. Talking about the adoption of CI/CD, I will turn to my colleague, Ravi. Ravi, can you walk us through the journey of zero-touch automation?
Absolutely. As being the consulting arm of AWS, we work globally with our telecom operators to help them transform their network on AWS. And we observed a few challenges that the customers go through. I can summarize them maybe in 3 points. The first one is really the entry to cloud. Now, before the CSPs or the operators can actually deploy their workload on AWS, there is cloud foundation that has to be in place to allow them to connect to their on-prem, the account structure, the governance, the billing, the security that they have to impose to different parts of the organization. And that can be a cumbersome for operators to use and build. It could take from 6 months to 1 year to do that. The second one is really the best practices. And as we say in AWS, there's no compression algorithm for experience. And these are the things that we learn working with customers like Dish, for example. How do we actually efficiently deploy workload in AWS leveraging best practices from everything as a code, from DevOps, CI/CD pipelines, using technologies like GitOps as well to implement the workload efficiently. And the last one is really all about the tools and services that can be used. Now, there can be many software tools and services, even in AWS, that can be used with telecom operators. And the question becomes, which is the right tool for the job in hand that need to be used? In ProServe, we actually build an internal framework we refer to as zero-touch automation, which is really a highly customizable framework that is built to fit the customer need. And the point of the Zeta framework is to accelerate the path to innovation. And the framework encompasses all the components and elements needed to end-to-end automate the lifecycle management of workload, including day minus one, which is all about security, about the connectivity, the account structure, and also day zero, which is really about the infrastructure automation and the lifecycle management, taking advantage of CI/CD and GitOps approaches. And day one is really how do we deploy the workload, whether the workload is written to use the GitOps approach or whether it is being supplied as part of a Tosca file. For example, these were TMB as a service that we recently launched can be used for that purposes. And finally, everything about the lifecycle management of the configuration, including the observability and monitoring. And this framework, in fact, if you look at the Dish, for example, when we worked with Mavenir, we were able to deploy 600 CU of Mavenir workload on AWS in less than 4 days. And this is really the power of the automation when we implement it in real life scenarios.
I'd actually follow up, and that's a very good point that you brought up on the 600 sites a day, because when we started this journey, there were learnings on both sides, if you recall, right? AWS brought the experience of having automated thousands, millions of workloads for enterprises, which is slightly different from the way telco workloads start in terms of how management happens, the high availability requirements of telco workloads. So I think that journey has actually educated both sides in terms of understanding how does your CI/CD pipeline need to adapt to support telco requirements. And the specific workloads, for example, on the RAN side for CU, we talked about CU, it's enabled us to actually get Dish to say, we turn up thousands of sites in a day. It's actually, they say, literally say it's 1,000 sites a day. So everything is wired up, and now with this capability, we are able to turn on, once everything is wired and set up, 300 sites, 300 CUs, physical CNAPs in a day, right? That sort of change was not possible before we got to cloud-native deployment. So, and this is a conversation that we continuously have with the CTOs in all companies. And I was just coming off a meeting with the RNC group CTO, Laurent, and his question is Open RAN TCO still matching what the traditional ones are? And the answer is OPEX is a key part to realizing the TCO. There are some of the parts of the CAPEX that we're still working through, but OPEX plays a key role in realizing that benefit. When Tariq at Rakuten says that I can remanage my entire network of today, he's got close to 50,000 cells on 4G and 5G, and we've got 8,000 sites in Dish. Again, that's actually 40,000 equivalent cells for from Rakuten definition, the way they count radios versus cells. My point is that you're able to run that with a very small subset of employees. In the past, if you look at the ratio of operator, number of employees managing the number of nodes to how AWS does it, automation was the key. The order of magnitude is like 100x more, because if you manage thousands of servers with two or three people, and that is an automation benefit versus in an operator environment. Like today, that's the challenge even in brownfield deployments, right? You have to retrain the existing employees that's there that's not in tune with the methods of operation. They're still used to the traditional mop method where at night you schedule a window and you do things. And here you need to continuously develop, continuously fail, relearn, and deploy fast, right? So we're getting to that stage now with brownfield, at least a few of the early adopters. Yeah. We'll go through that curve, and we'll see at some point that these laggards also catch up. But absolutely, we believe that is the path to take, and automation is the only way to realize those benefits.
Thank you, Bejoy, for Mavenir's awesome collaboration in using AWS CI/CD. As my colleague Ravi mentioned, we have used AWS internal services, and we are very excited that we launched a new service called TNV. Let me follow up with one question. How are you integrating with service orchestrators from your TNV?
No, absolutely. So AWS Telco Network Builder exposes APIs, REST APIs, SOL3 and SOL5. So we basically have the API for service orchestrator to leverage direct calls to AWS. We've demonstrated that as part of our demo, which is actually a multi-partnership demonstration. We integrated with an orchestrator from Cloudify. The cool thing with AWS Telco Network Builder is we also have SDKs that are available for native integration with the application from Mavenir and other ISVs. So Telco Network Builder provide the experience through the GUI, through the CLI, through REST API, and through SDKs. So that help our customer from an operational perspective at the GUI level, because a lot of customers may not have the expertise to start coding and really code use cases. Right? And then we have the CLI for a little bit more advanced users, and we have SDKs and APIs to integrate with third-party application, because really we understand that our objective is just to abstract the complexity of operating into the cloud, and we want to enable our partners and our customers to do what they do best, right? Which is basically manage the network. Right? So the optimization of the network itself. But we want to provide you with that abstraction so you don't have to worry about the infrastructure and about the lifecycle management on the infrastructure. So you can update the network, you can deploy to the network, you can upgrade the network, you can use the versioning of the network function and the network service descriptor, which make it easier for yourself. Because at the end of the day, you want to concentrate on the network function and continue to innovate and bring new features for your customers.
That's great, actually, because I didn't get a chance to see the demo. I'd like to see it right after. But the way you guys have taken out that use case of automation and turned it into a use case that consumers could relate to. I know that some of the challenges that we had initially walking through as we were building this product together, the end result is really good, because what it helps us realize is take these different workloads, use that tool set that you guys have developed to run it natively in AWS Cloud and do it fast, leveraging your benefits, right? Up until this point, it was about our product running in the pipelines in private clouds. So it's usually a VMware, a Red Hat. We have our own stack as well in a tier one in the US with hundreds of millions of users. And we've gone through that experience understanding what it takes to actually automate and integrate these workloads. So I'm excited that AWS is kind of like the first hyperscaler to come out with a telco productized version of this. So the learnings would certainly help both companies, I believe, down the road as well as we scale and try to deploy it across multiple accounts.
Thank you, Eamon, for talking about how you were integrating with a service orchestrator, especially the API play. I was really fascinated. Bejoy, talking about APIs, right? How is Mavenir looking at moving towards an intelligent programmable network?
So I'll talk about it from a network perspective and what we're seeing our operators actually do. So just as day before yesterday, you had Abdu and Ulf from T-Mobile and Deutsche Telekom make an announcement about network exposure. It's directly tied to how you turn network into a platform for new services. So up until this point, operators have always been just a dumb pipe. So they put all the investment in for 4G, billions of dollars investing in their network, but then you have applications that over the top just went over because it was always seen as just a connectivity pipe. And the way you convert your network from a connectivity pipe into an actual services platform is you offer APIs, which means that the underlying products which enable those APIs needs to be cloud native. Yeah. Needs to be microservices, so you could leverage these APIs. The good thing is at least in the, and probably this is, you guys are probably not involved in this from, where the telecom industry has had a long history of trying to monetize their networks through those APIs, but were never successful because you had the likes of Twilio and others come in with APIs that the long tail understood. And this should be no news to AWS because you guys are so good at doing these APIs and getting the long tail customers on. Telcos were never successful in this. So now there are new initiatives, something called Catalyst Project, Kamara Project, where they're trying to simplify the APIs and expose capabilities externally. So, for example, this DT joint announcement with T-Mobile And it's not just two operators. I just referenced it because it just was just announced yesterday and was written a lot about it. There's Telefonica, there's many other accounts. Dish, for example, they have their own play as well in terms of network exposure. So some of these initial use cases around how do you get quality on demand? How do you trace the user location through an API? And it's slightly different from the API that you just referenced, which is around the service orchestration, SOLT 3, SOLT 5 kind of APIs, which is primarily around how do you orchestrate and manage the workload. I'm tying these two together because when you launch new services, and let's take QoS on demand, quality of service on demand as an example. If I'm offering that API, which is basically a turbo option where, as needed, I can provide higher throughput, which means that I may need to scale out a network function as and when it's needed, which is where the API that you just referenced becomes relevant, because if I need to have a cloud-native instance spun up automatically and dynamically as needed based on a triggered API call that's exposed from the network, you need the service orchestration integrated with the network workload. And this is something that truly was a vision with OpenStack deployments, but never really took off because the orchestration space was not really integrated with the network. And we're starting to see some early phases of where orchestration benefits could be seen in this cloud native network. But that is truly the vision. If we think about how we're looking at a non-reactive network, a more proactive network that's driven through automation, then you need the orchestration as a big part of it.
I want to add to that actually, because what the work that we've been together is extremely important, right? Us showing that we're able to orchestrate the network and the application at once is actually extremely critical for the network API work that we're also doing. And a lot of customers have been actually asking us, how can I deploy the application? How can I place the application throughout the edge continuum to benefit from the network? So us showcasing that we can use one common template with very little modification ultimately, and the little modification is, where do I want to run it, right? And with one little modification, we can deploy the network and deploy the application in the right spot so the customer can benefit it at the end.
And so rightly,
that's amazing.
And rightly, the vision for AWS is to make it really seamless to deploy an entire network on AWS, whether it is on the region or on the edge or even on local premises, encompasses services like Telecom Network Builder, the one we launched. So the focus can be shifted toward using that platform to drive those telco as a service API capabilities and help CSPs monetize their network in a way that will make it beneficial to them, and help CSPs monetize their network in a way that will allow developers to have access to their services and deliver customer differentiative solution to their customers.
So thank you, Bejoy. Thank you, Ravi. Thank you, Eamon. Really appreciate this exciting conversation. Really inspired. And how we can bring automated digital operations utilizing the power of cloud and truly marching towards the vision of intelligent programmable networks, 5G networks, and how we can enable these high-end use cases that how Ravi has talked about. And you talked about the vision from OpenStack days, everybody were trying to do it, and how we are truly coming to the age where we can realize this self-healing, automated operations, all these high-end use cases that we can enable through automation. I'd like to ask if you can add one final statement and share your final thoughts for this session.
I think a lot of investment has happened in 5G. We are in the early stages, but we need to monetize in 5G, and we talk about these use cases. The way to monetize is you have to launch new services pretty fast, and that requires automation. So I think it's key to the work that we're doing together is going to be key to realizing that vision on monetizing 5G.
Thank you, Bejoy. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Varo.
Bye.